Doom Eternal, the anticipated sequel to Doom 2016, has been out for a while now. While originally scheduled for release in November 2019, Doom Eternal's release was pushed back to March 2020. Even though I couldn't wait, I'm glad they've waited a bit longer to perfect everything, because it seems to have paid off. Doom Eternal was the first game in a while that I actually got upon release, and I even decided to get the deluxe edition, cause why not? Its software did the impossible and managed to improve almost every aspect of its predecessor. And while it's never been more fun to kill demons, there are certain aspects where Doom Eternal falls a bit short. Nothing game-breaking, but there are some additions or changes that might not please everyone. One of them is the story. Let's see where we left off from last time. So the story takes place 2 years after the events of Doom 2016. Earth has been overrun by demonic forces, wiping out 60% of the planet's population in the progress. The Doomslayer, having previously been betrayed and teleported away by Dr. Samuel Hayden at the end of Doom 2016, makes a return. His goal? Killing the Hellpriests, Deck Nylux, Rennec and Greff. The priests serve an angelic being known as the Canemaker, who seeks to sacrifice mankind. It's not long before the Slayer manages to kill Deck Nylux, but thanks to the Canemaker, the other two priests are teleported to unknown locations. So there's nothing left to do for the Slayer but to keep looking for them. During his search, he is halted by the priest Doomhunter Guardians, but it doesn't take long for the Slayer to end their lives. After that, there is no hiding for Rennec, and the Slayer kills him. The Slayer is forced to retrieve Hayden's robot cases, since he knows the location of Deck Greff. A Morrodor, a demonic sentinel sent to stop the Slayer, tries to stop Doomslayer, but as expected fails. Upon uploading Hayden's mind into the fortress, he reveals Deck Greff is hiding on Sentinel Prime. After researching Sentinel Prime, the Slayer's past is revealed. The Slayer, who is identified by the name Doomguy, is revealed to be from Earth. Despite knowing it is against the Sentinel law, Slayer kills Deck Greff after defeating his guardian, the Gladiator, and returns to the fortress. More of the Slayer's past is revealed. During Hell's invasion of the Sentinel's world, a rogue servant to the Canemaker imbued Doomguy with superior abilities, transforming him into the Slayer. Eventually he finds the Canemaker and stops the ceremony by using the Betrayer's dagger to destroy the Icon's heart. Free from Maker control, the Icon of Sin awakens from its dormant state and manages to teleport to Earth. A battle between the Slayer and the Canemaker takes place. The Slayer manages to kill the Canemaker, he then teleports back to Earth. After an intense battle, the Slayer kills the Icon of Sin by stabbing it in the head with the Crucible Blade, putting an end to Hell's invasion of Earth. There's a lot more focus on the story in Doom Eternal than in Doom 2016. While the predecessor gave you the bare minimum needed to go on a killing spree, the story was still there, but there were almost no cutscenes and thus you really didn't have to pay attention to the story, the sequel gives more background information and tells more about the story of the Slayer. This results in a lot more cutscenes and even a few instances where you hear the Doomguy speak. I don't mind the extra cutscenes, and if you want to, you can still skip them. It's actually nice seeing the Doomguy more often. Which was probably a decision because you can customize the look of Doomguy, and if you would never see him in cutscenes, well, what's the point? But the story is serviceable and still enjoyable to follow, but for me it's never the focus of the game. The cake is definitely the gameplay, and the story is just the cherry on top. Even though it might not be the tastiest cherry. As the Doomslayer, you have access to a variety of powerful weapons, such as the combat shotgun, super shotgun, heavy cannon, plasma rifle, chain gun, ballista, rocket launcher and the BFG 9000. Most weapons function the same as Doom 2016, but a few changes have been made. The super shotgun is now equipped with a meat hook, which you can use to grab enemies and slingshot yourself towards them. You will even need to use it to defeat one of the bosses. You have the ability to equip your weapons with different weapon mods. Each weapon can have up to 2 mods. You can get these by finding mod bots scattered around the map. A few weapon mod examples are the sticky bombs from the combat shotgun, micro missiles the heavy cannon can fire, and the energy shield from the chain gun. These mods can be upgraded for things like faster recovery or reload speed. To upgrade your weapon mods, you can use points you get by clearing a room of demons or finding secrets. Per mission, you can get up to 10 points you can spend to upgrade your weapon mods. If you've purchased all the upgrades for a weapon mod, you unlock the Mastery Challenge. If you complete the challenge, you'll get an extra upgrade in return. These challenges usually revolve around killing a certain number of enemies with one shot or dealing a certain amount of damage while using the weapon mod. You can also use coins you can find in the map to bypass the challenge and unlock the master ability immediately. Aside from your firearms, you have melee weapons such as the Doomblade, Chainsaw and Crucible Blade. The Doomblade is used to finish off enemies with awesome glory kills, which drop extra health. The Chainsaw's purpose is to kill enemies for ammunition drop, and the Crucible Blade is a powerful tool you get later in the game that kills most demons in one hit. But if those weren't enough new additions, the Doomslayer also has access to a shoulder-mounted equipment launcher with the ability to lob grenades and ice bombs. Additionally, the Flame Belch is a flamethrower which causes the enemies set on fire with it to drop armor pickups. You can spend Petora's suit points to upgrade your grenades and ice bombs to deal more damage, have a shorter recharge time, and even to drop health when upgraded. You can also equip up to 3 runes which grant you abilities like faster glory kills, slowing time while in the air, or letting glory kills recharge your dash ability. To upgrade your ammo capacity, health or armor, you can use sentinel crystals you can find on the map. Unlocking 2 upgrades in the same category unlocks a passive ability, things like the flame belch taking less time to cool down. Lastly, you have the new life system. Instead of a single life like in Doom 2016, you now have extra lives scattered around the map which you can collect. Every moment when you would normally die, a life is used and you regain all of your health. But when you run out of lives and die, you won't regain your lives. Which is frustrating, especially if you're playing on the higher difficulties. Not really a bad thing, but I found the things you can collect and level up to be a bit overwhelming at first. In the first few hours, the game just introduces so many things. New weapons, weapon upgrades, relics, stone upgrades, suit upgrades, challenges. So that might halter your progress a bit and seem a bit too much, but you soon get used to it and then it's no longer an issue. Just like its predecessor, the game encourages the player to aggressively engage the enemies. It's clear from the get-go that a passive approach is not a viable option if you want to survive. You need to be moving constantly to end up on top. Early on in the game, you gain the ability to double jump, and just a bit later you're able to dash forward. These become essential to maneuver around demons and to prevent yourself from getting cornered. I must admit that I had to get used to the fast controls and gameplay since it's been a while since I played Doom 2016. But once I got familiar with the fast movement, it felt so satisfying and rewarding to kill all the demons till there were no more demons left. There's a huge difference in how I played in the first few hours and the way I played in the last few hours of the campaign. In the beginning, you might find yourself overwhelmed, but the later in the game, you will be the one kicking the demons' asses. The game consists of 12 missions taking place in various locations like Earth, Exculpia, Neckerfall and Urdak. In each mission the objective is marked, but you're free to explore the areas to find secrets and collectibles. Secrets and collectibles are even more fun to discover and collect than in Doom 2016. You can collect dolls, albums, cheat codes or find secret ammunition, extra lives or upgrades for the Doomslayer. You can also find the optional secret encounters which earns you points that you can use to upgrade your weapon abilities. Aside from that you also have Slayer Gates, these are also optional. These are intense encounters where you're dropped in an arena and if you manage to survive you get more weapon points. You first need to find a key to be able to open the Slayer Gate and start the arena challenge. The keys aren't that hard to find and are usually hidden somewhere near the gate. If you complete the arena you also get the Empyrean key. If you collect all 6 keys you can activate the Maker device and get access to the bonus Unmaker weapon, which is found in the Fortress of Doom. The Fortress of Doom is a new hub area you can visit between missions. The base contains a number of rooms with upgrades and gear locked behind doors, which you can open by using power cells. You can also look at all the items you've collected while exploring the world. I found this a surprising but welcome addition to the game. During missions you usually move to an area, encounter some enemies and do some platforming. It definitely feels like Doom Eternal has more platforming sections than its predecessor. This isn't necessarily a bad thing though. New movement mechanics such as wall climbing, dash moves and horizontal bars to swing from have been introduced to make the platforming more versatile. I actually liked the platforming a fair bit, though there were certain sections that were quite difficult to figure out. But luckily you only lose a bit of health and spawn right back where you jumped off. After platforming or doing a puzzle you usually end up at an arena where it's not long before it's swarming with enemies and it's up to you to survive. There are also some parts where you have to collect keys or certain parts to progress. They never feel tedious however. In Doom 2016, there were a few moments where I got lost and had to look up a guide to figure out what I needed to do. These all occurred in the beginning areas, and the solution was usually a keycard I missed. This kept me from enjoying the game in the first few hours. But luckily after that I understood the hints the game gave me, to help me progress further. In Doom Eternal I never got lost or had to look up a guide. Maybe I was already used to the hints the game gave me to find my way forward, or they made the way forward easier to figure out. If you pay attention, you'll start to notice how they'll guide you to the next area, which is usually with green lights. Gone are the old days where you had to distinguish a grey part from all the other textures, since that was apparently a switch you needed to activate to progress further. In terms of things I dislike regarding the world, I would first point towards the radiation areas. The radiation is quite damaging, especially when you have all kinds of enemies attacking you at once. Figuring out which way to go while getting damaged by radiation is not enjoyable, though I luckily had plenty of lives. Aside from that, you also have the purple goo areas, where you are unable to jump or dash and can't move at your normal speed. These can also be a bit annoying, but they only occur in such a small part of the game that it really isn't that bad. A lot of enemy types from Doom 2016 make a return, though their looks have been redesigned. There are also new types of enemies, such as the Morrodor and Doomhunter, while others such as the Pain Elemental, Ragnotor and Archivale have been reintroduced from previous Doom entries. Compared to Doom 2016, basic enemies serve more as a way to get ammo by killing them with your chainsaw. Punching these enemies is no longer a viable option to get rid of them, as your punch only seems to tickle them. You'll find yourself running out of ammo more frequent, and thus you will need to find more enemies to cut in half. A new system called Destructible Demons is introduced in Doom Eternal, in which enemies' bodies become progressively destroyed and deteriorated in combat as they suffer damage. With this system, certain parts of a demon's anatomy can be destroyed to eliminate their ability to use their stronger attacks. All the demons differ from each other, and for each demon a different approach is required to kill them. The shotgun might be useful to get rid of a Hell Knight, but is almost useless against enemies like the Doomhunter. As a result, the combat isn't just mindless shooting, but actually requires strategic thinking, which makes the arena sections filled with enemies really enjoyable, especially if you manage to pull it off with taking almost no damage. In terms of bosses, I find them inferior to the three bosses we got in Doom 2016. Except for the final boss, they all have a weird mechanic revolving around firing when something like their eyes blinks green, which is usually the only way to stagger them and deal damage. I especially had a hard time during the Morrodor boss fight, because you need to keep him at mid-range for him to perform his green blinking attack, which sounds a lot easier than it actually is. He teleports all over the place and can also summon a dog, which can be quite a nuisance. And then if he does the attack, you need to make sure you fire as fast as possible or he'll just pop up his shield again. I definitely lost a lot of lives during that boss fight. Unfortunately, the Marauder becomes a normal enemy later in the game, which means you'll have to fight him even more times. There is even a secret encounter where you have to defeat him in 30 seconds, but after the first attempt, I threw in the towel because I knew there would be no way I would be able to beat him in 30 seconds. Then I later picked up the towel again because I realized you could use cheats to complete missions. With cheats, it's really easy to do. The third boss fight is a lot less tedious. The gladiator does the green attack much more often and you don't need to keep him at a certain range or anything like that. And as a result, that fight was a lot more enjoyable to me. The Cane Maker boss fight can also be difficult, but for another reason than the Morrodor boss fight. The bosses no longer drop health or ammo, which means during a boss fight regular enemies spawn to make sure you don't run out of ammo. With the first few bosses this is A-OK, but with the Cane Maker boss fight it's frustrating because you can't use the chainsaw on regular enemies and you need to score headshots to get ammo. With the boss and them attacking you, this can be quite chaotic and frustrating. But aside from that, I never had a problem with it during the other boss fights. But the final boss fight is definitely the highlight for me. It's not your traditional boss fight and more often than not, you're just fighting regular enemies. The goal is to damage the Icon of Sin enough that his armor is destroyed, and in the second phase, to destroy every part of his body to be able to finish him off. This is where the Destructible Demon system comes into play again. Out of both Doom 2016 and Doom Eternal, I found the Icon of Sin boss fight to be the most enjoyable. But the other three bosses in Doom Eternal are just average at best. So when you pick up this game, don't expect anything from the bosses. Facing off against demons in arenas are easily the highlights and most enjoyable parts of the game. After you've completed the campaign, you can hop into the less impressive online battle mode. This is a 2v1 PvP mode, where you can play as the Slayer and or fight against two demons controlled by other players. If you decide to play as the Demon, you have the option to play as the Morrowdor, Mancubus, Pain Elemental, Revenant and Archvil. There will be more playable demons included with free updates post-launch. In addition to regular attacks, each demon has a summoning wheel, which contains a selection of 4 additional abilities, designed to make the matches more difficult for the Doomslayer. As the Slayer, you have access to all of your weapons and abilities from the game, which sounds overpowered, and well, if you've mastered the campaign and know how to play this game, it is. I've got to say though that I haven't played Battle Mode aside from the tutorials, and I'm not really planning to. For me it feels a bit tacked on, and I would have been fine with just the campaign. I actually prefer the multiplayer from Doom 2016 over this one. The only reason why I would play this Battle Mode is if I would go for the Platinum Trophy, because there are a few trophies you can only get by playing Battle Mode. But aside from that, I personally have no reason or desire to play Battle Mode. In terms of graphics, the game just looks amazing. The different areas just feel so alive and are absolutely stunning, even though most living beings have been killed and only demons remain. In terms of enemy design, the game aims to have a closer resemblance to the original Doom games. The enemy designs have thus been modified from the 2016 game to match the designs of the original games. If you're not busy killing demons and you pay attention to the background, there's always something to catch your eye. This makes the areas even more enjoyable to explore, as everything just looks so amazing and you are rewarded for your curiosity. But that's not all. The game is also accompanied by a kick-ass soundtrack to get your blood pumping while killing demons. The soundtrack is once again composed by Mick Gordon, and it's as good as his previous work on Doom 2016, if not better. I'm not really a fan of rock and heavy metal music, but even I enjoyed the amazing tracks whenever it's demon slaying time. I imagine that if this is your first FPS, it can be really difficult because Doom Eternal doesn't hold your hand. But if you manage to beat it, the reward is huge. All other first-person shooters will feel very slow after playing this fast-paced action game. With awesome gameplay, amazing graphics and a kick-ass soundtrack, you get a fantastic game. Though it's not perfect, with a forgettable multiplayer mode and mediocre bosses, no one can deny that this is one of the best shooters you can play on the PlayStation 4. So if you haven't played it yet, what are you waiting for? Grab your weapons, 'cause it's time for you to start slaying demons.